Good evening, aspirants. Welcome to the Hindu newspaper analysis brought to you by Shankar IAS Academy for the date 26th of November 2021. So these are the list of news articles chosen for today's discussion. If you can see, we will be discussing four different articles. First will be about the cryptocurrencies. Followed by that, we will be discussing an important article regarding NFHS 5 report. Followed by that, we will be discussing another important article regarding the GST. And finally, we'll end our discussion by discussing about the MG Narega scheme. So let us move on to the first news article discussion now. Now for our first discussion, let us take up this op-ed article. See, this op-ed article is entirely about cryptocurrencies. If you remember, in the year 2018, Reserve Bank of India, they banned financial institutions from enabling cryptocurrencies. But what happened last year is, that is in 2020, what happened is Supreme Court overturned this order. And ever since, investors are rushing into cryptocurrencies. And what happened recently is the central government has announced that in the upcoming winter session of the parliament, it will introduce a bill seeking the ban of private cryptocurrencies with some exceptions. So this is the entire crux of the news article. So in this discussion, we'll see in detail about cryptocurrencies. What is a cryptocurrency first of all, and what are the advantages and disadvantages, and we'll also discuss about its unique features, which will be very helpful for your prelims and mains examination. The relevant syllabus is highlighted here for your reference. Please go through it. Now, first of all, what is cryptocurrency? See, to understand cryptocurrency, you must have a basic understanding about what is a virtual currency first. See, a virtual currency is a digitally transformable form of value which can be used as a medium of exchange or a stored value which can be utilized later. So, similar to physical currencies, virtual currencies are digitally transformable form of value. So, in physical currency, you'll transact physically, right? But in virtual currency, you'll transact digitally. So, it can be used as a medium of exchange or it can be used as a stored value which can be utilized later. See, many countries are planning to give legal tender status to the virtual currencies. But know that India has or have not given the status of legal tender to virtual currencies. Now, just to recall, remember, a legal tender is a guarantee given by central government. And all the parties who involved in transaction, they are legally bound to accept it as a mode of payment. So if a currency is given a legal tender, all the parties are legally bound to accept that currency as a mode of payment. But in India, so far we have not given legal tender status for any virtual currency. Now coming to cryptocurrency, see, cryptocurrency is a specific type of virtual currency which is decentralized and protected by cryptographic encryption techniques. Bitcoins, Ethereum, Ripple are a few notable examples of cryptocurrencies. So cryptocurrencies are nothing but it is a specific type of virtual currency which is decentralized and protected by cryptographic encryption techniques. Now, what does this word decentralized means? See, decentralization implies that there is no central authority where records of transactions are maintained. Instead, anyone can create a transaction. This transaction data is recorded and shared across multiple distributor networks through independent computers. So, this technology is actually known as distributed ledger technology. And cryptocurrencies actually employ this distributed ledger technology. Just remember, a distributed ledger is a database that is consensually shared and synchronized across multiple sites or institutes or geographies, which is accessible by multiple people. So, to put it in simple words, distributed ledgers are data recorded that are shared among multiple parties. See, they can be classified as permissioned or permissionless. It depends on whether the node or the network member require permission from any entity to make modification to the ledger. And remember, this distributed ledger can be classified as private or public also. And it also depends on whether they can be accessible by anyone or only the network's participants. Overall, it actually allows transaction to have public witnesses. Let us see how. See, the participants at each node of the network can access the records shared across that network and can own an identical copy of it. And even any changes or additions made to the ledger are reflected and copied to all participants in a matter of seconds or minutes. As I already said, independent computers are used in distributed ledgers to record, share and synchronize transactions in their own electronic ledgers. So, this eliminates the requirement for a traditional ledger to keep data centralized. Take for example, there are three persons, A, B and C. They are connected through distributed ledger technology, which means that all the three, that is the A, B and C, are connected through individual computers in their place. So, if any transaction is actually happening, all the three members can access the informations of that transaction if the permission is provided. So, if A wanted to see the transaction made by C, even though he does not know the person, he can actually see the transactions because they were connected through distributed ledger technology. As simple as that. So, cryptocurrency is a specific type of virtual currency which is decentralized and protected by cryptographic encryption techniques. And they use a technology known as distributed ledger technology. Now, there are two principal ways in which cryptocurrencies are raising money. First, through initial coin offerings, where digital tokens are issued in exchange for other currencies. So, if you give 100 rupees, you will get digital token equivalent to that 100 rupees. So, this is known as the initial coin offering. Through this, cryptocurrencies are raising money. Secondly, through using it as a mean of exchange or a payment system. See, cryptocurrencies can be used as a means of exchange or payment system, and many countries are using it for payment system, and this is the second way through which the cryptocurrencies are raising money. See, as of February 2019, there were more than 2000 cryptocurrencies across the world with a market capitalization of approximately $120 billion. So, just imagine the significance of these virtual currencies. Now, let us see what actually cryptocurrencies offer different stakeholders. See, traditionally, gold has been one of the best way for investors to protect themselves not only from inflation, but also from the danger that comes with any monetary sector, right? Like gold, now cryptocurrency is another such asset that allows people to invest outside the traditional financial system. See, another primary advantage of cryptocurrencies is the mathematically designed blockchain network with finite supply. See, if you remember, the primary problem with the current monetary setup is that when the government starts printing more money, the value of your money gets wiped out due to high inflation. You don't have this problem with Bitcoin. So, this is the primary advantage of cryptocurrencies. So, cryptocurrency is a sounder fundamental currency with finite supply. Apart from this, systems and processes such as decentralized finance systems can be built on top of the blockchain networks. This has many advantages. For example, when you transact money to your friend in the US, you are in India and you have to transact money to your friend in the US. There are significant charges that you incur if you go through any major bank in India. See, it is a friction that can be eliminated by the use of technology, and cryptocurrencies help you to the maximum in this way. See, blockchain technology itself has great potential to reform financial record keeping and keeping track of asset transactions. If you remember, in the days just after demonetization, people were actually looking to invest in cryptocurrencies. See, when people see that the value of a particular asset can be wiped out overnight by a government order, that is enough to create some amount of distrust in the good, right? So, while cryptocurrencies may not be immediately used for going into a store and purchasing something, but they are essentially a hedge against any system-wide action that could wipe away the value of any given item or any particular asset. The fact that cryptocurrencies exist outside the reach of government, this itself provides them an advantage over cash or fiat money as asset. So far we discussed about what is cryptocurrencies, how it works, and we also saw how cryptocurrencies are raising money, and we saw what actually cryptocurrencies offer to different stakeholders. Now we can see what is the actual reason why Bitcoin become prominent in these years. See, the main reason is that the value of fiat currencies was being eroded systematically. Right from 2008, due to quantitative easing, money supply was increasing, and every time the government turned on the money printing machine. Because of this reason, the value of money that you saved went down, and this is exactly the reason why the fundamental value of Bitcoin became a great store of wealth. Now let us see the issues surrounding Bitcoins. See, a committee was set up in 2017 by Minister of Finance to study issues related to virtual currencies and submit its report in 2019. The committee recommended that all private cryptocurrencies should be banned in India. The committee noted various regulatory concerns around virtual currencies and cryptocurrencies in particular, and let us see them one by one. The first is the fluctuation in prices. See, cryptocurrencies are subjected to market fluctuations, and the lack of centralized authority make it difficult to regulate them. So this is the first issue and a very important concern also. For instances, in December 2017 alone, the value of Bitcoin cryptocurrency was around $20,000 per coin, which reduced to $3,800 per coin by November 2018, which means cryptocurrencies are actually subjected to market fluctuations, but they do not lead to inflation. So just note this difference. In advantages, we saw that cryptocurrencies actually do not increase inflation, but it is subjected to market fluctuation. So this is the first concern. Now the second concern is the risk to customers. See, there are several vulnerabilities in the design of cryptocurrencies, which leaves customers open to risk of fraud. These include phishing, cyber attacks, and Ponzi schemes. And very important point to note here is that cryptocurrency transactions are irreversible, which means once a transaction is done, there is no way to remedy it. So this posed a very serious risk to consumers. Followed by that, there was a severe impact on power consumption. See, using cryptocurrencies can have unfavorable consequences on India's energy demand. If you remember, we just discussed there is a distributor network, and validating transaction in a distributor network involves high electricity consumption and it requires high computation power. And the committee noted a study which estimated that 19 households in US can be powered for one day by the electricity consumed in a single transaction of Bitcoin cryptocurrency. So just imagine how much amount or how much quantity of electricity consumption will be there in each transaction of cryptocurrency. So this actually poses a severe threat to India's energy demand. Fourthly, there are risks of potential use for criminal activities. See, the Financial Action Task Force, which is an international organization to combat money laundering, in its 2014 report, it observed that virtual currencies provide greater anonymity than traditional payment systems. See, this makes them more vulnerable to money laundering and illicit funding for terror financing. So this is an important point to note. According to the committee, while cryptocurrencies or virtual currencies do not offer any advantages, the underlying technologies behind them has many potential applications both in finance and non-finance sectors. I have given them in the table below for your reference. Just go through it. It will be very helpful for your mains answer writing. Now coming back, see, every time there is a problem, the solution is to print massive amount of money. And every time the government prints money, it creates irreparable damage to people, especially at the bottom end of the society. Moreover, money printing is not an economic question. It is a political question. See, there is always more demand among governments to spend than the supply of funds available, right? And in order to satiate that demand, more money is printed. And in this stage, banning cryptocurrencies will only create an underground market and people will continue to invest in it. And it will be hard to regulate. So, no single instrument can have all the advantages. So, we can figure out which technology or which currency works better for what purpose and then think of some ways of creating a financial system which harnesses all these new instruments rather than cracking down on them. So this is what the article actually tries to convey. So in this discussion, we saw about what is a cryptocurrency and we saw about virtual currencies. And we saw that a cryptocurrency is a specific type of virtual currency. We also saw how a distributed ledger technology works. And we also saw some of the advantages of a distributed ledger technology. Followed by that, we saw how cryptocurrencies are raising money. And we saw what are the offers provided by cryptocurrencies to different stakeholders. And we also saw the reason why Bitcoins became prominent after 2008. And we also saw some of the issues surrounding it, which were noted by a committee which was set up in 2017. So with these takeaway points, now let us move on to the next news article discussion. See, our next discussion is going to be based on this editorial, which provides a comprehensive picture of the findings of National Family Health Survey 5. See, it mentions the gains and losses made in the health and social sector. This NFHS 5 is the fifth in the NFHS series and was for the period 2019 to 2021. So what does it actually provide? See, it provides information on population, health and nutrition, and this information is available for India, for each state or union territory, and even district level estimates are available for many important indicators. We discussed about this in detail yesterday. Today, let us focus on the health related findings alone. The syllabus relevant to this article is highlighted here for your reference. Please go through it. See, overall radical improvements could be witnessed for many important health indicators. According to author, this was made possible due to government policies and interventions. So let us see the survey findings and these indicators one by one. We'll also see government policies and intervention in indicators that made improvements and author's view simultaneously. So it will be very helpful for your mains examination. Please make a note of these points. First is the major indicator of maternal and child health. See, this indicator covers several sub-indicators. Let us see one by one. The first one is the antenatal care. That is ANC visits. See, it is a preventive health care essential for protecting the health of women and their unborn children. See, under this, women learn about healthy behaviors during pregnancy, warning signs during pregnancy and childbirth, etc. They also get access to micronutrient supplements and required treatments. And it is advised to receive ANC 4 or more times. That is, to put it in simple words, antenatal care visits. They are actually a preventive health care essential for protecting the health of women and their unborn child, under which the woman learns about healthy behaviors during pregnancy. And it is advised to receive 4 or more times of ANC visits. And as per the NFHS 5, this has increased almost 7% from NFHS 4 period. That is from 2015 to 16. When you compare the latest edition, it has increased almost 7%. This increase could be attributed to the government scheme Pradhan Mantri Matru Vandana Yojana, PMMVY, which is effective from 2017. See, what does this scheme actually provide us? It provides maternity benefits in the way of cash incentives. And the second installment of cash incentive is provided after receiving at least one ANC. So, this scheme incentivized ANC, leading to this increase. So, this led to an increase of 7% when compared to last report. So, this is the first point to note. Next is the consumption of iron folic acid during pregnancy. See, daily oral iron and folic acid supplement is recommended to prevent maternal anemia, low birth weight and preterm births. See, as per NFHS-5, there is an 80% increase in intake of this supplementation. This success could be attributed to the National Iron Plus initiative of the government. See, it was launched in 2013 and this initiative is a broader umbrella addressing anemia holistically. So, it encompasses programs for all the categories of population, including pregnant and lactating women. So, under this initiative, pregnant and lactating women actually receive 100 milligrams of elemental iron and 500 mcg of folic acid tablets for daily consumption for 180 days during pregnancy and 180 days after childbirth. So, this initiative have actually boosted the intake of the iron and folic acid supplementation. And as per NFHS-5, there is an 80% increase in the intake of these two supplementation. So, this is the second point to note. Now, moving on, next sub-indicator is the average out-of-pocket expenditure per delivery in a public health facility. See, out-of-pocket expenditure refers to the direct payment made by individual to the healthcare providers at the time of getting service. So, these are expenditures borne directly by a patient when insurance does not cover the full cost of health good or services. Here, I should point out that India has one of the highest level of out-of-pocket expenditure in the world because 17% of the population spend more than 10% of their income on health. This is higher than the global average. Now, as per NFHS-5, there is only 8.7% reduction in out-of-pocket expenditure for delivery from NFHS-4 period. So, there is no drastic improvement from NFHS-4 period and the NFHS-5 period. The out-of-pocket expenditure has been reduced, but only 8.7% reduction has been taken place. Now also, it is near to ₹3,000 even in a public health facility. So, this marginal gain is attributed to the Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojana, which was launched in 2018. If you remember, we have discussed about this scheme a lot of time. And just to recall, PMJ provides financial affordability to health services to a large percentage of Indian population in the form of insurance cover. So, to some extent at least, PMJ enabled health insurance to the population. Next is an important indicator of delivery care, which is institutional birth. See, delivery care means births delivered by skilled birth attendants or health personnels. So, here institutional birth assumes importance. Institutional births is nothing but it refers to the proportion of births occurring in health facility in the area such as hospitals. So, when a birth is taking place in a hospital under a skilled birth attendant or health personnel, those births are taken into account. See, there is a 10% increase in institutional birth in NFHS-5 period compared to NFHS-4. And we can find that almost 89% birth are institutionalized. Therefore, there is a definite reduction in home deliveries or births. See, this success could be attributed to the Janani Suraksha Yojana, JSY, which was launched in 2005. See, under Janani Suraksha Yojana, beneficiaries receive cash incentives for institutional delivery. So, this intervention has resulted in a phenomenal growth in institutional deliveries. So, this is the fourth point to be noted. Now, moving on, next indicator is full vaccination of children in the age of 12 to 23 months. See, we know that vaccination is important to develop protection from a disease, right? So certain compulsory vaccines are recommended for children after childbirth. Here you can see an image. See, the NFHS5 covers many of these vaccines like BCG, measles containing vaccines and 3 doses each of polio, excluding polio vaccines given at birth, and DPT or penta vaccine. See, according to the survey, more people received their vaccination in the period 2019 to 2021 compared to 2015 to 2016. Now, again, this gain could be attributed to Pradhan Mantri Matru Vandana Yojana, among others, because the third installment under the scheme is provided only after childbirth is registered and the child has received the first cycle of these vaccines. So this cash incentive has increased the vaccination status among children. Now, sixth and the final comes the important health indicator for children under 5 years of age, which is the nutritional status. See, this indicator covers child stunting, child wasting and underweight. For those who are not aware, wasting measures the share of children who have a low weight for height. It reflects acute undernutrition in children. Then, child stunting measures the share of children who have a low height for age, indicating chronic undernutrition. See, there is only a bit of improvement in these compared to 2015 to 16 levels, and according to the author, this marginal improvement is insufficient. Now, the scheme or policies for addressing child nutrition issue or Anganwadi service schemes, Poshan Abhiyan schemes, etc. Among other interventions, the programs strive to reduce the level of stunting, undernutrition, low birth weight in child and low birth weight in children. But prolonged school closure due to pandemic has affected the implementation of these schemes and therefore affected the balanced nutrition for children. Now, another health indicator is for adults. See, it is blood sugar level and hypertension among adults of 15 years and above. See, these two are the most prevalent lifestyle disease and result in many complications such as blood vessel damage, heart attacks and kidney failure. See, in NFHS5, the health range for these health conditions have been expanded. Thus, comparison with NFHS4 is not available, but from the data for the period 2019 to 2021, it could be found that more than 13% of the adult, that is men and women, have high blood sugar level. Similarly, more than 21% of adults have elevated blood pressure and hypertension. See, these numbers are quite worrying. So, for the first time, NFHS5 highlighted the looming threats from lifestyle diseases in the 15 years and above population. So, overall, we can witness radical improvement in maternal and child health. This was made possible by the policies. Thus, the policies seem to have borne fruit. But in some places, the effort seems insufficient. So, what is the need now? See, government requires renewed corrective efforts. There is a need for building resilient and fortified systems. Such systems should never fail in any circumstances, even if we witness another pandemic. So, such kind of renewed corrective efforts is required for the government as of now. Thus, finally, author has concluded with certain suggestions to achieve this. First of all, the data under NFHS5 should be used to shape the policies and do corrections wherever needed. Because NFHS data is the second largest after census data, the data will help in identifying deficiencies. Yesterday, we discussed about the importance of this survey. So, using these data to shape the policies will help us in the longer run. Secondly, since the data is also provided for states, the states can compare their results. They can learn from one another rather than disputing the data. See, in a similar manner, center should also use the data and comparison to launch reforms or to reassess certain policies wherever necessary. So, with this, we came to the end of this news article discussion. In this discussion, we saw about NFHS. Specifically, we saw about some of the survey findings of NFHS 5. In that, we discussed about a major indicator of maternal and child health. In that also, we saw some of the sub-indicators, and we saw how the government policies and interventions helped to improve these indicators. And finally, we also saw some of the important recommendations given by the author. So with these informations in mind, now let us move on to the next news article discussion. Now let us take up this article for our next discussion. See, this article is about the possibility of bringing in 3-rate GST structure. First of all, let us see the existing rate structure of GST in India so that it will be helpful for you to understand the possibility. See, the goods and services tax, that is the GST, is an indirect federal sales tax that is applied to the cost of certain goods and services. Here, the business people, they actually add the GST to the price of the product, and a consumer who buys the product pays the sales price inclusive of the GST. Here, the GST portion is collected by the businesses or sellers and forwarded to the government. So this is the existing structure, and remember, India established a dual GST structure in 2017, which was the biggest reform in the country's tax structure in decades. See, the main objective of incorporating the GST was to eliminate tax on tax or double taxation, which cascades from the manufacturing level to the consumption level. Previously, the system without GST implies that the tax is paid on the value of the good and margin at every stages of the production process. This would actually translate to a higher amount of total taxes paid, which is carried down to the end consumer in the form of higher cost of goods and services. So the implementation of the GST system in India is therefore a measure that is used to reduce inflation in the long run, as the prices for goods will be lower and by eliminating tax on tax. See, India has been implementing 5 tax rates. We shall see them one by one. First is the 0% tax rate. These tax rates are applicable or applied to certain foods, books, newspaper, homespun, cotton cloths and hotel services. So these taxes are applied to certain goods and services. Secondly, the tax rate of 0.25%. 0.25% is applied to cut and semi-polished stones. Thirdly, a 5% tax is applied on household necessities such as sugar, spices, tea and coffee. Fourthly, a 12% tax on computers and processed food. And then 18% tax on hair oil, toothpaste, soap and industrial intermediaries. The final bracket, that is taxing goods at 28%, actually applies to luxury goods including refrigerators, ceramic tiles, cigarettes, cars and motorcycles. Apart from this, note that luxury and demerit goods are subjected to cess on top of the highest slab. That is, above 28%, they may also attract a cess above it. So, according to the article, multiple rate changes which were brought since the introduction of the GST regime have actually brought the effective GST rate to 11.6% from the original revenue neutral rate of 15.5%. See, here you might wonder what is this term revenue neutral rate means. See, revenue neutral rate is a structure of different rates established in order to match the current revenue generation with revenue under GST. So to put it in simple words, it is the actual rate of revenue return which has to be collected by the government by imposing GST. So here the revenue neutral rate is 15.5%, but actually after implementation of GST, the effective GST rate now is only 11.6%. So this is causing a mismatch, right? Here the revenue for the government is declining. So, a proposal to merge the 12% and 18% slabs into a single rate has been discussed for several years. However, no proposal on this has been made at the GST Council, which will take a call on it. So, if the council actually approves the merger of the two rates, items such as goods, butter, cheese and spectacles may become expensive, while soap, kitchenware and apparel may become cheaper. If you remember, former Finance Minister Arun Jaitley, he also had called for merging the two slabs. He said that a roadmap should be made to work towards a single standard rate instead of two standard rates of 12% and 18%. See, it could be a rate at some midpoint between the two also. If this happens, the country will have a GST that will have only slabs of 0%, 5% and a standard rate with luxury and sin goods as an exception. But the problem with this is, if the GST slab of 12% and 18% are merged to form a new slab, somewhere in between, the tax burden on items currently in 12% will go up. On the other hand, tax on items currently at 18% will come down. Now let us see what the 15th Finance Commission actually urged. See, the 15th Finance Commission urged restoring the rate neutrality of GST, which was compromised by rate cuts. It also said that restoring revenue neutral rates will mean merging the rate of 12% and 18% and operating with a three rate structure of a merit rate, a standard rate and a demerit rate of around 28% to 30% and minimizing tax exceptions. So, in that line, a study by National Institute of Public Finance and Policy, that is NIPFP, says that the government can rationalize the GST rate structure with a three rate framework, and merging the GST rates 12% and 18% into any tax rate lower than 18% may result in revenue loss. But the study by NIPFP proposes that GST Council consider three rate structure of 8%, 15% and 30% for revenue neutrality, and the nature of rate changes is such that 40% of taxable turnover value fall in the 18% tax slab. So, to reduce the 18% GST slab to lower rates will affect the revenue of the government. So, keeping this in mind, the study shows that the revenue loss can be compensated by marginal hike in other remaining major rates, which are 5% and 28%. So, with this, we came to the end of this news article discussion. In this discussion, we saw about GST, how the existing GST actually works. We also saw some of the tax slabs, and we also saw some of the recommendation given by our former Finance Minister Arun Jaitley. We also saw the recommendation given by 15th Finance Commission. And we also saw what will happen if 12% and 18% slabs are merged. So, with these facts in mind, now let us move on to the next news article. Now, for our last discussion, let us take up this news article. See, this news article reports that an additional fund of 10,000 crore rupees has been allocated to the Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Scheme. See, this scheme has been ran out of the funds which were allocated to it in the budget. So, this is the reason why additional fund of 10,000 crore rupees has been allocated to the Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Scheme. So, this is the news here. Now, based on this context, let us see some of the important points about the scheme. See, the Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Act, which is also known as Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Scheme, that is MNREGS, is an Indian legislation that was enacted on August 25th, 2005. See, this Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Act is the foundation for the Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Scheme. See, you would have heard a lot of time about the scheme, but you would have not noted down what the scheme is actually about. So, we'll discuss what the scheme is actually about and we'll see how the funding is done and we'll see about the scheme in brief. See, it is an social security measure which aims to guarantee the right to work. See, each citizen have a right to work And in order to guarantee that, this Indian law was enacted. And it is a social security measure. So, the main features of MNREGA is that it provides a legal guarantee for 100 days of employment in every financial year to adult members of any rural household who are willing to do public work related unskilled manual work at the statutory minimum wage. So, the scheme actually provides a legal guarantee for 100 days of employment in every financial year. To whom? To adult members of any rural households who are actually willing to do public work, which is a unskilled manual work at the statutory minimum wage. So, this is the scheme is all about. And very important point to note here is that roughly 1/3 of the stipulated workforce must be women. And the Ministry of Rural Development is monitoring the entire implementation of the scheme in association with the state governments. So, make note of these two points. Ministry of Rural Development is monitoring the entire implementation in association with state governments. And another important point is that roughly 1/3 of the stipulated workforce must be women. See, the entire idea behind the scheme is that the Gram Panchayat is the principal forum for the wage seekers to raise their voice and make demands, right? So, this scheme is actually a demand-driven program. For those who are not aware what is this term demand-driven program actually means, see, demand-driven program refers to a development strategy where the people themselves are expected to take the initiative and responsibility for improving a situation rather than being passive recipients of the government services. So, what the wage seekers they do is they raise their voices and make demands to the Gram Sabha. And this program is entirely a demand-driven program in which the people themselves take initiative and responsibility for improving the situation instead of being a passive recipient of the government services. See, majority of the work under the schemes are related to agriculture and allied activities. Apart from this, they work to facilitate rural sanitation projects also. And very important point to note here is that the sources transferred from the center to the state is based on the demand for employment in each state. So, the funding of this scheme is shared between the center and the state. Now, coming to the expenditure part, see, there are three major items of expenditure. They are wages. These wages may be for an unskilled or semi-skilled or skilled labor. So, the first expenditure is wages. Secondly is the material cost and thirdly is the administrative cost. So, in this, the central government bears 100% of the cost of unskilled labor, 75% of the cost of semi-skilled and skilled labor and 75% of cost of materials and 6% of administrative cost. See, you don't have to make note of these factual data. Just remember that the central government does not entirely fund for all the three types of labors. So, these are some of the important points that you have to note about MNREGA and we need to know about MNREGA. So, in this discussion, we saw about how the act was formed, we saw who implements the scheme and we also saw the main features of the scheme. Apart from this, we also discussed about the expenditure incurred for the scheme. So, with these informations, now let us move on to the next part of the news article discussion. Now, let us see some of the prelims practice questions. Now, look at this first question. This question is about cryptocurrencies. Which of the following statement is incorrect regarding cryptocurrencies? Option A, cryptocurrency is a specific type of virtual currency which is decentralized and protected by cryptographic encryption technique. Option B, it has the status of a legal tender in India. Option C, cryptocurrencies are subjected to market fluctuations. And option D, cryptocurrencies leave consumers open to risk of fraud such as phishing, cyber attacks. See, the correct option for the question is option B. As we have already discussed in our discussion, we insisted or we recalled the fact that cryptocurrencies are not the legal tender in India. So, the correct answer or the incorrect statement here is the option B. It has the status of legal tender in India. Now, look at this question. This question is about MNREGA scheme. In the context of the Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Scheme, consider the following statements. First statement, it provides a legal guarantee for 100 days of wage employment. Second statement, it is a demand-driven program. Third statement, state are incentivized to provide employment under the scheme. Which of the statements given above is or are correct? Option A, 1 only. Option B, 1 and 2 only. Option C, 3 only. And option D, 1, 2 and 3. See, if we had carefully paid attention to my discussion on MGNREGAs, then you can easily conclude that all the statements given here are correct. Because the main feature of the scheme is that it provides a legal guarantee for 100 days of employment in every financial year to adult members of any rural household, which are willing to do public work related unskilled manual works at the statutory minimum wage. So the first statement is right. As I told you, this is a demand driven program where the provisions of the work is triggered by the demand for work by wage seekers. And therefore, the resources transfer from the center to state is based on the demand for employment in each state. And this makes the second statement to be right as well. And when you take the third statement, it is also right because the act incentivizes the states to provide employment as 100% of the unskilled labor cost and 75% of the material cost of the program is borne by the center. And since all the statement given here are correct, the correct answer here is option D, 1, 2 and main questions are displayed here. Please go through it and write an answer and post it in the comment section. With this, we came to the end of the news article discussion. If you like the video, like, comment and share, and do subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel. Thank you.